Ah! He's not alone.
Hallelujah.
So he's married to his dad.
Yeah.
They are married to his dad. Then education-wise, he did a Bachelor of Business Management at Moi University. Then passion, printing of the true word, worship. Then our topic today, real or false. And our subject is existence of God. Our subject is existence of God. So help me appreciate our speaker. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are before the presence this morning. And I pray that you will speak to our hearts. Thank you for your servants. I pray for human actions that cannot be forbidden. We love you, for you are our God and you are our Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. It's good to be here again. It's always a joy. I thank the Lord, and you can wave at me like this. Praise the Lord. Yeah. I thank God for today, the opportunity to come and share His word together with you. As you have heard, I'm married, and I came with the love of my life. Yes. So I appreciate her if she comes to say hi. She's an alumna of this place. We met when I was doing ministry here. Together in the prayer worship and the preaching of the word, discipleship, and then for the opportunity. So the topic of today is like a question: does God exist? This is a very wide topic, by the way. We may not exhaust everything. Those who are planning to do theology, when you go to Bible school, you will meet a topic of the doctrine of God. It is a very wide topic. So I will take that through by the grace of God. You may have your notebook so that you know this is more of a teaching topic. You need to preach some things. And because you are university students, I believe all of you are, there is going to be some hard meat to challenge your thinking. Are you ready for that? Are you ready for that? Yeah, because for sure I want to tell you that the world we are in today, people are investing time to read on how to counter the preaching of the true word. People are sitting in libraries for hours and hours to try and read so that they have some basis of challenging your faith. And if you're not going to be founded strongly, and if you're not going to invest in study and reading of the word, I am telling you, you will be so challenged until you feel like quitting. I want to tell you that some of the places, you may know the truth, but some of the places you will get more time is like in the street, where you can ask questions, you can discuss. If you don't get answers, you can still meet again and discuss. I enjoyed the street even when I was here, as I facilitated the street. That is where you expose the word of God in depth. But today, by the grace of God, I believe we will get something. Praise the Lord. And you will leave this place with something in your heart. So, does God exist? Is it a fact or fiction? Does God exist? Can you ask your neighbor, does God exist? And if he does, how can you prove it? Can you ask your neighbor, give me one proof that God exists? And quickly, just ask for an answer. That is the way it will be, for sure. I wish this was, we had more time to make it more of a discussion, because it would be so nice to hear feedback, but I will try. So, if God does exist, please, just one. We are not saying explain, find points, you know. Just one. Anybody who has enjoyed something by a neighbor? Can you shout one, my brother? You want to shout one? Oh, she said none. Anybody want the other thing? One. This is the opportunity. Just shout it wherever you are. One. So all of us here can close this door and say, don't believe in God. So I leave you to ponder on that. But we will look at it in two ways. One, we look at the biblical response. What does the word of God say? And then we will look at other responses, but that are affirmed by the word of God. Because we will realize there are other responses that do not necessarily quote the Bible, but they concur and agree with the word of God. Amen? Yeah. So how about you? You may not write everything, but I will guide you on what you need to note down, because we have some many points to pick. So open the Bible, the book of Isaiah, chapter 46, verse 9 and 10. Isaiah 46, 9 and 10. I will read. Remember the former things of old, for I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. Declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times, things that are not yet done. Say, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. That is Isaiah 46, verse 9 to 10. That's the first thing that God speaks about himself. As we are going to see, even as we study about this today, is that he is self-existent and eternal. We will see some attributes of God as we conclude later, and he will be able to relate with them personally and even with what we see in our environment. But let me just begin by saying that the basis of apologetics, and I hope you know what apologetics is, it is defending our faith or answering, responding to questions raised about our faith. That the basis of apologetics is only the Bible. Praise the name of Jesus. If we remove the Bible, if we remove the Word of God from our equation, then our faith misses everything. So sometimes when you are arguing with some people, you may hear them tell you, put the Bible aside. Say this, I argue on the basis of what I believe. Argue on the basis of what you believe. So that whatever I say must be in line with the Word of God. So the basis of our apologetics is actually the Word of God. The Word of God has more authority than any other writing in the world. Why? I will prove it. Because the Word of God has not just been written by one author, the way a person would just do a book and say, I'm an authority in this and that. The Bible has been written by so many authors, and not in one time. It is over 1,000 years. I think we shared this last one minute thing about the Word of God. Maybe with another group, I don't know whether all of you are here. But it has been written over 1,000 years with consistency and coherence. The Word of God has been written by various authors, some of them learned, others not learned, lawyers, accountants, of course tax collectors like Matthew, and doctors, some of them were fishermen, simple people, simple women, simple men of God, learned, rich, all kinds of authors have written the Word of God. Tell me a book that has been written over 1,000 years. There is none. So the basis of our explanation as we talk about the existence of God, for us it is the Word of God. If we, for example, let me just ask a question to us. If you are completely blindfolded in a small room, a dark room, somebody completely blindfolds you, and then they keep you in a room, and there is someone in that room who is very quiet, motionless, not talking, doing nothing, and is seated there, then you are blindfolded and taken to that room. And if you are asked, is there anyone else in that room? You can say no. Why? Because you can't see. Praise the Lord. You can confidently say no, because you cannot see. And that is the way many people don't believe in God. They have something that has blindfolded their thinking and their eyes, such that God is there, but they cannot see. That's why they will stand tall and say there is no God. Why? Because they cannot see him, or they cannot even perceive that he's there. So what you need to tell them is remove whatever has blindfolded you, and surely you will see God. When I say that, if you took a small fish and just threw it in your swimming pool, a small tilapia, when it has never been in another pool, and you let it swim and swim, it will say, this is the biggest pool I've ever seen, because it has not seen enough. If you can speak to it and tell it, there is even a bigger one called the ocean, it can deny. Why? It has never seen. That is the way our faith is. So, when we speak about faith, we need to know that the foundation of our faith is Scripture. Now, I'm trying to look at a comparison between the Word of God and the other people who are arguing, the scientists, the philosophers, theologians,
and even atheists themselves, I looked at what they said, and I saw what some of them said when they were atheists, and others who converted what they said. And we briefly see that. So the existence of God cannot be proved or disproved on just another basis. Because the Bible says that we must accept the fact that God exists. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He wants those who honestly seek Him. That is Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. So what we are saying, Hebrews 11, 6, is saying that without faith, it is impossible to please God. So, for us, it is not that God cannot reveal Himself. And by the way, you remember the time that Moses wanted to see God? What happened? God told him, I will just pass, and you will see me. The Bible says that by the time the presence of God was passing by, Moses was already down, and he said that no one will see God and live. It is not because God cannot reveal Himself physically so that you can see Him. It is not that it is impossible. But because He has exalted His word, that's why it will be meaningless if we cannot see God by faith. And that's why He says, we believe in Him by faith. So if God just reveals Himself to another way, then the word will have no meaning. Because He reveals Himself to us because we have faith in Him. And we must believe that He is existent. We are still looking at what the Bible is saying about the existence of God. That is Hebrews 11, 6. Jesus told him that in John chapter 24, 29, Jesus told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. The basis of our faith is believing. The basis of our religion is faith. Praise the name of Jesus. The Bible says again in Psalms 19, 1 to 4, please note down so that you can read in your time. It is good to confirm. But the Bible says in Psalms 19, 1 to 4, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of His hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their voice goes out into all the earth. Their words to the ends of the world. So even what we see, they speak about the glory and the existence of God. One is what it was had. Another one that amazes me is Psalms 14:1. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. So you meet somebody who says there is no God, including some great scholars like Sigmund Freud, we will mention about him, that believe not in God, and they say very negative things about God. You will realize at the end of the day, they were fools. The reason why some of them were fools, actually there is one philosopher, those who do literature, you do philosophy, I can't remember that one of the philosophers who committed suicide because he tried to seek for truth until he could not get it. So the only option was suicide. That was a fool, isn't it? How can you seek for truth until you commit suicide? The only definition is Psalms 14:1, that surely if you do not have God and you say God is not there, that's why you must die, because surely you don't believe in Him.
Hallelujah.
So the Bible is telling us that people will reject the clear and undeniable knowledge of God and believe a lie instead. Romans chapter 1 verse 25, it declares, they exchanged the truth. Romans 1 25, they exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator. Surely you must have such a great faith to call yourself an atheist. I normally say, if you can worship what is created, your faith is open because you are very sure that this thing was created by someone.
Yes.
Isn't it? Your faith is very great, only that it is misdirected. Your faith is so great that you can worship an idol that was created by a human being. Your faith is so great, only that it is misdirected. You only need to turn and ask, whatever you are worshiping, and where did you come from? Who created you so that I can worship them? Because your faith is so great to worship what is created, rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Hallelujah. So we need to understand that many people are lost because they are worshiping the creation instead of the Creator. So people claim to reject God's existence because it is not scientific or because there is no proof. But the true reason is that once they admit there is a God, they also must realize that they are responsible to God and in need of forgiveness from Him. Now, the reason many people deny that God is there is because they want to do whatever they feel like doing. Because they feel they are not responsible to anyone. They feel like I should choose. You know, you hear the things of today that my dress, my choice, my whatever, my choice. Everything is about what I feel. I hope our sisters, you are not also saying my dress, my choice as you come to the fellowship. Praise the name of Jesus. Because they want to just do whatever they feel like doing. But I want to tell you for a fact that in your life you are responsible to someone. You are not just an accident. You exist for a reason. You are not just by chance. Hallelujah. So, those who deny that God is existing, they are blinded in their thinking and they are limited in their exposure to reality. So we want to get to the other responses on that are affirming God's existence, even as we look at this question. Is there any conclusive proof of God? Is there any conclusive proof of God's existence? I posed the challenge to you, and I asked you, and I wanted just one proof. So let's look at now the myth I was talking about. We will mention some scientific facts, some philosophical, some ideological, and such, so that when you are challenged, you have something to say. Praise the name of Jesus. So, one thing I want to ask you is, can we reach out to God and touch God or see Him in the same way that we touch and see people? Definitely the answer is no. God is not physical. As much as it's not physical to be seen, He is very present and close to us. There are countless ways that we can reveal, both in science and the Bible. And I will begin, and this one you need to note down in brief, because this is a research by some scholars, and they have agreed, and I look at what they say, and I also agree with them. Of course, when you are doing a study on such a topic, you cannot just be an authority yourself. You must look at what other people are saying and relate it with the Word of God. And see, if this person saying what the Bible is saying, and if you realize there is consistency, even as much as other scholars are challenging them, you will realize that many of them are very sound and sober. And as you go on, you will realize that science affirms the Word of God. Praise the name of Jesus. Science affirms the Word of God. How many people here are doing science courses? One thing you will tell us is, by definition, what is science? It is a systematic study of the nature and the universe in a way of observation and experimentation. So you observe, you see, an observation of what you hear, what you see, what you feel. It is everything that you observe and what you can sometimes practically experiment on. test some laws, some principles, and establish them. One of them that he came up with is called the law of cause and effect. Cause and effect. It is also by other scholars. I'm married to someone from Central, with the roots of Central. So when you hear scholars and the others, just accept. Hallelujah. Other scholars have called it cosmological argument. Cosmology. I know you are not the people who are the professor. Cause and effect and cosmological argument. The same. It's actually the same. And this one is talking about everything that exists, it must have its effect, and every effect has its cause. The basis of science. So this one is like we are saying that every effect must have a cause. The universe and everything in it is an effect. There must be something that caused everything to come into existence. Ultimately, there must be something and cost in order to cost everything else to come into existence. The uncaused cause is God. Let me ask you, if things just happen, if things just happen, if the earth just happened, if you just happened, if you are just created, then it means the creation should continue. So your eyes should even move from where they are in the lens. You know, things should just be happening, isn't it? Yeah. Because if they just happened, they should just continue happening, isn't it? You should just be being created. Maybe now you turn to a cow, within no time the speaker turns to a monkey. You know, things just should be happening. Because if they just happened, how did they begin happening and stop happening, isn't it? So those are the things we need to ask atheists. Those who just say the earth and the universe just happened. You need to ask them, if they just happened, why is it that we see the sun rise from the east? We have not seen it come from the west at least 1 or 2 days. And say, okay, things are just happening. The sun now is coming from the west to the east, or from the north to south, or the sun has just disappeared anyway, because things have just happened. And just imagine if things were just happening and the sun fails to come. Then you hear in news, it is announced over all the media stations at CNN and wherever, Al Jazeera, the sun has just vanished. Are you getting the point? About everything must have a cause. And every cause must have an effect. That's what you need to take home. So that if you argue with an atheist or these people who don't believe in God, ask them, did you just happen? If you just happened, then why are you not still continuing to happen? We should see you with another that leg. Because things are just happening. You are just a chance. So it means that we should not even have such forms of similarities as human beings. Because if people just happened, some should have 5 legs, others 10 hands, others 20 eyes. We should just see things that happened. Are you getting the point? So we need as students and scholars to have a basis of argument of our faith that surely we cannot just have happened. The universe could not just have happened. The earth could not just have happened. There must be a cause. And that cause has brought an effect. And the effect is what we see. The effect is of existence. The effect is the existence of the universe and the beauty and the splendor of what the cause brought. Hallelujah. The law of cause and effect. There must be some cause to any effect. So according to this law, the universe defined as time, space, matter, and physical energy had a beginning that is not eternal. And you will see that the earth is not eternal. Because anything that has a beginning must have an end. And the Bible says the same. So we are trying to see what the scientists have found out and what the word of God says. In Matthew, what does the Bible say? Heaven and earth, these ones that we see, Heaven and earth shall do what? Pass away. But the word of God shall remain forever. So this one ascertains and confirms that whatever has a beginning must have an end. And whatever is created has a beginning and an end. So, one of the people that people who study physics watch so much is this man who was called Einstein. And we are told that through Einstein's equations, scientists can trace the development of the universe back to its very origin, back to what is called the singularity event, when it actually came into being. So science has proven that the universe really did have a beginning. This means that if the universe had a starting point in history, then it obviously began to exist, and it must have a cause for its existence. Are we in agreement there?
Yes.
Amen? Therefore, the universe needs a cause for its coming to be. The last cause must be beyond the universe. Praise the name of God. That cause must be something similar. In fact, this is a scholar who is speaking, a scientist who is saying that cause must be something similar to what Christians call God. I like that. That cause must be something similar to what Christians call God. Now, there is one atheist who tried to search for truth. You know, he was trying to study very hard to disapprove or disprove that God does exist. But after he tried, it's called Richard Dawkins. He was a very prominent atheist. Richard Dawkins. And in a Time magazine article, he said, there could be something incredibly grand and incomprehensible and beyond our present understanding. Yes, and that is God. Praise the name of Jesus. One of the well-known atheists of our time, actually is not very historical, but Times magazine is still done today, and it's one of the world's, you know, quoted magazine. And when somebody appears there, it's a very honored person. This guy was one of the prominent atheists, and he came to a point and said, there must be something incomprehensible and beyond our understanding, and that is God. So, I want you to summarize this law with 5 points, which you can note down, because we can summarize this cosmological evidence in the following statement. One, whatever begins to exist must have a cause for its existence. Okay? With what we have said, that nothing can just happen by chance, because if somebody wants to claim that something just happened by chance, then they need to prove to us that when did it begin to happen and when did it stop to happen? Okay? That should be our basis to ask the question. That if you are saying this just happened, then at what point did they begin to happen? And at what point did they stop to happen? And what is happening? Is it coherent with what you are proclaiming that things just happen? So whatever begins to exist must have a cause for its existence. So the universe, number two, the universe must have begun to exist. And in that case, the universe, okay, the second one is the universe must have begun to exist at some point. Therefore, number three, it must have had a cause for its existence. It must have had a cause for its existence. And then the other thing, the attributes of the cause of the universe are the attributes of God. Therefore, number five, the cause of the universe must be God according to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. What does the Bible say in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1? Let's just say it together, 1, 2, 3. I thought that is the verse that we sang since when we were in Sunday school and small. Can we say it more loudly? In the beginning. Alright, let's open now and read. Let's open our Bible and read together. Are you there? Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. Let's go.
It is something beyond imagination.
There is no scientist who has not proven to me in my imagination what the sun is. The generosity is a mass of vast bits of gas. What? A mass of burning gases. But there is nobody in science who has ever gone with a test tube to just get one, you know, some mass from the sun and tell her, now I have come with a proof. Or even somebody who can say, I have visited the sun. There will be none. Praise the name of the Lord. So even for the scholars and the scientists and the philosophers, they are very limited in proving some things to us. They just tell us that we believe, because maybe we think that they have read some books, and these books have been written by others. So it's just a matter of taking knowledge, trying to think about it, comparing it, and you know, for us, we can compare the knowledge with the word of God, and that will be final for us. Praise the name of Jesus. But for someone who's saying, I just studied, let them just prove to us what the sun is actually and tell us I tested. Then we can believe that it is only God who knows what the sun is. The Creator. So, what we are saying is that with that exact setup, are we to believe that such a position just happened? Think about it. It is not possible that we just can believe that this thing just happened and no one was behind it. That one is not possible. Psalms 19, verse 1. When you read, I just mentioned a portion of that. That it says, the sun rises at one end of the heaven and makes the circuit to the other. So this one means that the word of God is also affirmed by this law. Now there is a man who was asked a question about the existence of grass. And he said, he was asked, do you believe that the grass that we see around just exists by chemical reactions? Because the person who was asking this was one of the people who believe in ABC. And this man said that if the grass just happened, the books of botany that we read should also have happened. We could be finding them on that grass. Then we just say, oh, this book happened on botany, and we read and get the explanation about the grass. If the tree just happened, the books that have been written about the tree here, they should just be under the tree, so that they tell us about the trees. So if books do not just happen, somebody has just read books that did not happen, and then it's telling us that other things just happened. You know, you have just read a little bit. And you know, by the way, being a university student, now you can attest that nobody has perfect knowledge about everything. The fact you come from primary, you have read a lot about everything. High school, you read several laws about several things. In the university, you specialize on a few laws about your area. When you master, you are beginning to reduce to 2 laws. When you go to PhD, now you find somebody talking about their human body. They are then specialized on the eye. So you ask them about bone, when they work as a specialist on the eye for 20 years, 30 years, they become so special in the eye. But when you ask them about the bones, they are forgotten what a femur is or the other things. It is possible. So the truth of the matter is, somebody reads books that have been caused to happen by someone, but they want to prove to us that other things just happen. That one is not realistic. The other one, which actually affirms the Bible, is the prophecy, the law of fulfilled prophecy. The law of fulfilled prophecy. Now, the theologians, I said that we'll be looking at several people, scholars who have done research about this. Theologians tell us that there are 1,093 prophecies in the Bible that refer to Jesus and his church. And each one of these prophecies was fulfilled. Read the Bible. In the Old Testament and related to that, New Testament. The Old Testament, as they say, contains 48 prophecies that pertain sanctification of Jesus. There is consistency and coherence. So, when we consider this prophet who came from different communities, you know, by the way, when people doubt the Bible, I read the Bible and ask myself, how can things just appear like these people went for a conference? These people did not go somewhere to a conference. These prophets, praise the Lord. We did not have a conference by Jeremiah, Isaiah, Hosea, Amos, and the others, and they say, let's write the Bible. Everyone, the Bible says that they got their revelation when they were so away apart from each other. But when you look at the writing of the Word of God, it is so coherent. You find Isaiah is agreeing with Hosea, and there is consistency on the prophecy about Jesus Christ. The truth of the matter is, these people were scattered in different places. There is no such a way that they can just write one thing, and they have not even gone to a class together. At least you know if you have been in a class of chemistry, there is something you can write that relates to what you are taught. But these people were so away from each other, and they wrote the word of God about the prophecy of Jesus Christ exactly with precision. This one must only have one cause, the Holy Spirit. So they wrote all that with precision and did not miss anything over all that period of time. Even one writer speaks about the same and has written a book on the scientific proof of the accuracy of prophecy and the Bible. So the truth of the matter is, the Bible with all its fulfilled prophecies proves the existence of God. So through this law, we will be able to see that the word of God is affirmed by the prophecy and the prophets that spoke about it. And whoever spoke, if you want to know about prophecy, if you ask, is the word of God the message of the Lord? No, we ask ourselves, if what a prophet proclaims in the name of the Lord does not take place or come true, that is a message that is not from the Lord. But if a prophet speaks things that happen, then that message is of the Lord. Prophecy has become controversial in these days of today, and you need to handle it with care and wisdom. Whatever for you to test prophecy, the Bible in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4 says, do not believe every spirit, but test to prove whether it is from God. So you have to be careful about prophecy, because prophets, and Jesus prophesied about this, that many will come in his name, and they will say many things about him. But we need to know that every prophecy must agree with the word of God. There is no prophet who has an authority other than the word of God, if they are preaching the true word of God. And finally, on this, so that we can get specific responses to the atheist argument, God is the creator. We have read that in Isaiah chapter 46, verse 9 to 10. The creator of the universe and the order of salvation, he says to us, remember the former things, those of long ago. I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times, what is yet to come. I say, my purpose will stand. I will do all that I please. We have read that. Finally, there is another one called moral law. And this one I don't learn much about, because you know that all moral law always refers to the law of God. When you say do not murder, all nations will say that, isn't it, in their law? Even the law of Cain. It is criminal to murder. It is criminal to what? To steal. Even when people steal money, that is still stealing. And it is criminal to steal. The law of God says the same. The law of God says the same. So many things that are in the many societies as a moral law. The truth of the matter is they agree with the word of God. So, as I finish, how do we respond to atheist arguments. One of the things, because this topic was given specifically, is that please, can you address the area of how can we confront the atheist arguments? We have mentioned several, and you will still pick others in the short time remaining. One thing that atheists do is they are not able to prove or deny the existence of God. What they do, they try to counter all arguments about the existence of God. So one thing I challenge them, if I need, or even if I look at this, is please, do not wait for me to prove and then challenge my proof. Prove that God is non-existent. If you tell them that, that is enough. Because the question is, I am proving to you that God is existent. Please prove to me that He is non-existent. Some will tell you, you know, bad things happen to people, such kind of things. Bad things happen because sometimes sin prevails in the world. But they should prove about the non-existence of God. And for sure, they only counter the responses given. Anything provides no basis of morality, no hope, and no meaning for life. While this does not disprove atheism by itself, if the logical outworking of a belief system fails to account for what we instinctively know to be true, it ought to be discarded. Without God, there will be no objective basis for morality, no life and no reason for it. Yet all things do exist, and so does God. So our argument is based on that moral law, that God exists. There are several of the atheists that were negative, because it is good to hear what they say. One of them was Karl Marx, and he quoted Thomas. He said that everyone believing in God must have a mental disorder that causes invalid thinking. No, that is why I have to quote Karl Marx, is because these are the things that, unfortunately, some of your lecturers will challenge you in class, isn't it? They tell you, according to the Greek scholar, Karl Marx, everybody who believes in God has an invalid thinking. That is what he said. As a mental disorder, in fact, that was bad. A mental disorder and cause invalid thinking. I wish we had time. This is the real philosophy. You know, we can argue about it. But the question is, how did he prove that those who do not believe in God two, do not have a mental disorder? How did Karl Marx? He just countered the belief in God, but it was not sufficient argument for him to prove the non-existence of God. So if a lecturer tells you that even Karl Marx says that you must have a mental disorder if you pray loudly in tongues, you know, the things of the spirit are designed by those in spirit. So when I speak in tongues to you, it is madness. For sure it is. Hallelujah. It is true. You will think that I am mad. Even a priest thought that this lady was praying for a son who was drunk. So it is true, you can miss the point. And just by your own imagination, because you think, and you are allowed to think freely, you can think I am mad. But let's engage on other things so that we know whether we are mad, or both of us are mad, or one of us. There is another psychiatrist who actually involves people doing education quite a lot, called Sigmund Freud. I know you have heard about him, especially guys doing education. He wrote and said that a person believing in a creator God was delusional and only held those beliefs due to a wish fulfillment factor that produced what he considered to be an unjustifiable position. Again, there is no atheist that is coming with a proof of non-existence. So you can ask your lecturer, please, if you believe in Sigmund Freud's argument, can you prove to me that God is non-existent? I will prove to you about his existence, but prove to me about his non-existence. There is another one called Friedrich Nietzsche, bluntly saying that the faith equates not to wanting to know what is true. But the question is, his colleague, a philosopher too, committed suicide trying to seek for the truth. There is a lot of arguments about this. So one of the things we need to be very clear is we stand with what we believe. So, what man, we need to ask ourselves, in one sense, man does not ask the question about God. His very existence raises the question about God. Just by asking, does God exist? You need to ask yourself, do you exist? And if you exist, how did it happen? Then we answer the question of the existence of God. In summary, how we can respond to these arguments, there are two people I liked what they summed and said that whether we argue it about existence or not, one thing we know that number one, something is existent. And number two, you cannot get something from nothing. You cannot get something from nothing. And unnecessary eternal something exists. Science and philosophy have disproven the concept of an eternal universe. In simple, we are saying, science and philosophy have agreed that the universe is not eternal. It will come to an end because it has a beginning. And therefore, an eternal creator exists. That is somebody called, he was a philosopher called J.S. Mill. Another one called Jonathan Edwards said three things. That they all agree, something exists, nothing can create something. Therefore, a necessary and eternal something exists. Hallelujah. So to date, we are saying, all scientific and philosophical evidence points away from an eternal universe and towards an eternal creator. From a scientific standpoint, honest scientists admit that the universe had a beginning. And whatever has a beginning is not eternal. In other words, whatever has a beginning has a cause. I want to conclude, I want to come to my conclusion on the attributes of God. We can prove that God is eternal, is the eternal creator, and he relates with his creation in the following ways. Number one, God is supernatural. According to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, we have said it is him who created the universe and everything that we see. That means that he is supernatural. Genesis chapter 1. We are now going back to the scripture to prove about his relationship with nature and with human beings. He is supernatural. Number two, he is powerful. According to Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 17, God is all powerful. God is all powerful. God, number three, God is eternal. According to Psalms chapter 90, verse 2, he is eternal. He has no beginning, he has no end. Because he causes everything that begins, and he causes everything that ends. It is him that is eternal. He is omnipresent, according to Psalms 139, verse 7. He is omnipresent. We worship a God who is very present. Brethren, do not be discouraged by these arguments, because they will keep coming. By the way, they will keep coming. You will be challenged about your faith, and you better be equipped with the knowledge of the Word of God. He is omnipresent. Our God is closer than a brother, the Bible says. God is timeless and changeless, according to Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. Our God is timeless and changeless. I wish we could say them so that they get you enough. God is timeless and changeless. Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. God is immaterial. God is immaterial. John 5:24, God is immaterial. There is another one you need to know. He said in the relationship. So God is personal. Our God is personal. Genesis chapter 3, verse 9 is personal. Well, even if you are personal affairs, God wants to be involved. Praise the Lord. Do you know that God is concerned about that cause that you are doing? Even if it does not sound very nice, even if the name is a statement instead of just a single name. And you know God can use the cause you are doing to change nations? Praise the Lord. He is personal. He wants to be involved in every small decision of your life. God is personal. Personally, I know that He is personal. He is concerned about your personal affairs. He is the only one you can confide in your personal issues. If you are struggling with issues, it is only God. You can go to Him as a father because He is personal and He is relational. And speak to Him as a father and as an eternal father who knows the beginning and He knows the end. He knows how you began your university and He knows how you completed. Praise the name of the Lord. He knows whether you are broke or you are loaded. Hallelujah. And He knows that you have needs and you can meet them. So do not be discouraged. God can keep and sustain. I normally say, if I went through campus, God is faithful. That is enough testimony for another day that you can go through your campus life. If I went through campus and stood for Jesus faithfully, what has he done? You can stand. Let nobody tell you, it's not when you are doing it first year. Maybe the whole community came together and told you, we are just wanted. When you go to the university, you know, it is full of bad people. It is only who is good. But as a prayer. But that one I have to underscore, that God is personal, He is concerned about every affair of your life. Even those of you asking hard questions, who will marry me? God knows. Okay, I know that is a cause, especially among the aspiring elders. Praise the name of the Lord. That is a question I know. Surely, look at this. Now, prayer in campus. Who is marrying me? Brothers are wondering, the society has changed. You look at yourself. The girls of today are running after guys who are driving heavy machines. You are wondering, when will I drive? That is another question. Our God is personal. He knows all those questions that you are asking in your mind. And He is faithful. I also have the same questions. Even when you are, you know, there are those are the personal things that you cannot pray loudly about. See, you find brothers who are bashendaing loudly, but when it comes to some specific that's God. Remember me. He is closer than a brother. One of the time. He is very personal. Very personal, by the way. And he does not gossip. So you can go tell your fellow sister that this brother is showing interest. Then you just find it all over the whole campus. But when you speak to our God, because He's personal, He does not gossip. God has said that. Our God is personal. So that one is something that you need to know, that He's personal. Now, another thing about our God is He is infinite. He is infinite. Jeremiah 23:24. When you read the verses, they will give you the clear meaning of what we are saying. You don't have much time now. You read Jeremiah 23:24 and also Deuteronomy 6:4. They are underscoring the same point. Our God is diverse, yet with unity. Praise the name of Jesus. Our God is diverse, yet with unity. According to Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, He is diverse. But He is yet with unity. He has created us diverse, but with unity. He knows how to match us. He knows how to make things perfect. He knows everything. He is diverse. He is a God of diversity. Yet not complicated diversity. Things don't just happen. When God designs the diversity, it is so coherent and consistent because he is a God of diversity. Hallelujah. And he is intelligent. Psalms 147, 4 and 5. He is intelligent. Our God is purposeful. According to Jeremiah 29:11, we usually say, quote these words many times. I know plans that I have for you. They are plans of good and not bad, not to harm you. Our God is caring. 1 Peter 5:6-7. God is great. Praise the name of the Lord. So, what I need to say is that God is the creator and indeed he exists. He offers the way of salvation that has been accomplished through his son, Jesus Christ. The Bible says, but as many as believed him, to them he gave the right to become the children of God, even to those who believe in his name and who are born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but God. That is John chapter 1, verse 12 to 13. There is a book, if you can get it, called I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist by Norm Geisler. That's a good book to read. I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist by Norm Geisler and Frank Turek. I know that some of us, apologetics is not usually a very interesting topic. Apologetics defending faith. You know, where someone is challenging you. But I want to tell you, every time you need to give an answer for the reason of what you believe in, what is reason, you need to delve and study the word of God. Because through that, it is the way you'll be able to challenge even those heresies